2.
Praise the Lord. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I greet you in the power and in the name of the only name that is able to save, heal, and deliver, and set the captive free, and that is the mighty and powerful name of Jesus. Something indeed happens when we call the name of Jesus, when we believe in the power of his name, and when we tap into the effectiveness of the name, everything has got to change. I greet you today, and I'm so grateful to God that I'm able to be talking to you today. I pray that by the time you see this hour power or this moment with the bishop at 7 o'clock, that you had a successful fast day today. We did start our fast today, our corporate fast and time of consecration, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, from the time you wake up until, I believe it is 3 p.m., from time you wake up until 3 p.m., we are fasting and praying. What are we fasting and praying for, Bishop? We are fasting and praying for the New Haven Missionary Baptist Church as we have reopened and are rebuilding the ruins and continuing on in Jesus' name. And we're also praying for a successful holy convocation for the Pilgrim Assemblies International, of which New Haven is an affiliate and a part of. And so those are the two things that I want you to be praying for during your prayer and fasting time. Praying for New Haven and its leadership as we reopen and get back to in-person ministry and just rebuilding the church, period, after being closed for a year and a half. And we're praying for the success of Pilgrim Assemblies International Holy Convocation, which begins next Wednesday in the city of Chicago, Illinois. And we are so grateful to God that we are able to come into the building for Holy Convocation. I want to remind you, and I'm going to do the same on Sunday morning, but I want to remind you that Pilgrim Assemblies 31st Holy Convocation is now open. It is fully open and all seats are open at the Freedom Temple Church that is hosting our Holy Convocation. So you do not have to register as you were instructed to do several days ago. You can just come, and of course, mask will be required, and all the safety measures. I believe they're taking temperatures and some of the precautionary measures that we started to see during the beginning of COVID are still going to be adhered to and honored. But there's no need to register because all the seats are open. So if you're coming to join us in one of those nights, one of the day sessions, feel free to join us there. I would love to see you. I would love for you to get away and come up and let's just have church in Jesus' name. If you need the schedule or the itinerary for the Holy Convocation, my team is continuing to share that information as we lead up to Holy Convocation so that it can be before you. And there's also going to be a flyer of all the speakers, presenters, and preachers, of which I'm honored to be presenting one of the days of Holy Convocation in the morning. I'm humbled and I'm encouraged and I'm excited. And I'm praying for our presiding bishop, our executive board, our College of Bishops, and all of our senior pastors, Episcopal vicars. We're praying for all of the designates that are going through the rigorous task preparing for consecration to the office of the bishopric and elevation to Episcopal vicar come 2022. So let's continue to pray, let's continue to move, and let's continue to be about our Father's business. I want to pick up where I left off with you last week in part 2 of the reason why we need the church. I believe that's what we conditioned that to be last week, and we talked to you from a very passionate place. I talk to you from a very passionate place because I do believe in the necessity and the power of the church. I really do believe in that. And I do believe that if you were ever a part of the church at any time for any amount of time, and if it ever affected your life and gave you strength and gave you the wherewithal that you needed to be able to sojourn from one segment of your life to the next, then you embrace what has changed you, what has helped you, and what has caused you to be who you are today. Where would you be if it had not been for the church in your life? I actually shudder to think what life would have been for me had I not embraced Christ and his glorious church. And there's going to always be a need for the church. I raised that in your hearing last week. There's going to always be, as long as Christ is still in heaven and on the throne and he has not raptured the church triumphantly in his second coming, the church is here and she's not going anywhere. It is the bride of Christ. And he promised that he would come back to receive the church. And he's coming back for a church without a wrinkle, a blemish, or any such thing. And so we praise God for that. And even though times have changed and what church looks like has changed, and a lot of the things we did and a lot of the systems we had in place have changed and have shifted, the church is still the church, and the glory of the church is still the glory of the church. And as we are continuing to go through this pandemic, we say post-pandemic, but the pandemic is very much still alive with now a Delta variant in the earth, and it's probably going to be here for quite some time, but it's going to eventually take the same position that the flu and the common cold and some of these other diseases that we deal with every day that we don't even see, but God keeps us from them with us being careful or being vaccinated or whatever the case may be. It will become a thing that we will eventually not embrace, but we'll know that it's in the earth. And once it's here, it's not going anywhere. And there will be other diseases and there will be other afflictions that will come into the earth, because that's just the way it is. But while all of these things are happening, Christ Church is moving on. And I know that in this season of virtual church, you know, we've had virtual church for a long time. Church has always given another option from being in the building. I can remember growing up as a kid at the Mount Vernon Community Missionary Baptist Church under then the leadership of my father in the ministry, the man that I began preaching under at the age of 16. I can remember us coming on 1310, the light, on Sunday mornings at 11 o'clock. We had a broadcast, a radio broadcast. We didn't have no cameras, but we did present our worship services on the radio, and people were able to listen in to the broadcast. Now, then that wasn't considered virtual. Around that time, I think the biggest thing going on the internet might have been, and this is probably going to tell my age, but some of my millennial people that's on that end will know what I'm talking about, Black Planet and MySpace. There was no Facebook at that time. And there was no Twitter. There was no Instagram. There was no TikTok. It was just those platforms that we used, and we were able to get the word of God out and the singing and the ministry of the church over the radio. As technology grew and times changed, people began to get on television. You know what I'm talking about, TBN, the Word Network, Daystar, and some of these other avenues where people could then televise their worship experiences. So now we went from listening to it on the radio to now seeing it on the television. Well, as social media expanded and grew, then Facebook came. And if you remember, there was no live capability on Facebook and for several years until most, not recently, but the last few years when I remember when the lives were introduced. And so now it made it cost effective for free for churches not to have to pay that money for the technology and the wherewithal to come on television. The listening to church on the radio, people still do it, but it is not as big as it used to be. Everybody has migrated to virtual means. So when the pandemic hit, can you imagine what the people at Facebook, the CEOs and the powers that be, were thinking? Because now the pastors that were not virtual at first, myself included, had to find a way to get the word out to the people because we couldn't come into the building. And so what that did and what it has always done, and I think I alluded to this last week, is it gave the opportunity and the convenience for you just to roll over, tap the notification if you receive push notifications from our page, and bam, I'm having church at home in my pajamas, rolling around in my bed, cooking and fixing breakfast for my family in the kitchen, riding along in the car. And it was supposed to have been for people that couldn't make it to the church. Now, I'm about to make you mad. Virtual means, after the church reopens and has reopened, is for people that can't come into the house of God for whatever reason. It's not for the able-bodied people who would just rather have the convenience of worship and not have it in person. It all boils down to what's convenient for us, what works for me today. And so that can be good and it can be bad, because while you're reaching the people that want to be at church but can't for whatever reason, you know, they're on vacation, they're homebound, they're sick, they're shut in, they got to work, they just can't get out that day, so they can still participate in the worship, they can still give, they can still hear the word. But I want to tell you that, and here, even at New Haven, we are doing everything we can do, spending money and bringing in people to get our lives to the level that you deserve on a professional level, so you can hear and be able to feel and see what we feel and see. But I have a little announcement for you today, and you may not like it, but I'm going to tell it to you anyway. Church at home via Facebook and YouTube is not church in the building. Come on, I'm going to say it again for somebody in the back. You have to turn the hearing aid up. Church at home is not like church in the building. I don't care how much we spend. I don't care how elaborate our sound system and all of the things that we have to have going so that you can be able to hear us and enjoy the worship. It just simply makes for a better presentation. But it will. There's a different feeling when you come into the house of God. There's a different glory that's in this house and that's in every church, where the glory of God and the power and the manifestation of his power is felt and allowed. You just cannot duplicate what happens here in the worship service. Now, you can feel God at home. You can feel, I've watched TV or saw a worship experience on television or on YouTube and on my Facebook, and I got happy, got excited, and I did feel the hand of God. I'm not saying that, because, of course, God is not limited by a phone. He's not limited by an app. He's not limited by virtual versus another. He is God in all components. But there is a difference. And I want you just to think about that. For those that, and I want to praise God for each week that we've been open. We're coming up on week four here. And I just praise God for those that I see slowly but surely coming in and coming back, the new faces. We took in some new souls on Sunday. And so God is doing a great work, but we have to address the elephant that's in the room, that you cannot duplicate what happens in the worship when you come into God's house. That it is just nothing like it. And I can't speak for anybody else, but I can only testify to this Zion. The power of God is here. He was here through the pandemic when we were in here preaching to the pews and to the camera lady. And he is here now that the people of God have reentered before COVID hit. One thing that we humbly prided ourselves on, if I can use that word loosely, was the fact that this was a place where the Spirit of God was free. We are a liturgical church. We're a church of order and discipline and structure, but we're not so disciplined, liturgical, and structured and high churched that we don't know how to let God be God. And that's the one thing I've always appreciated about this Zion, is that our ability and our willingness to let God come in and heal and deliver, if that's what he wanted to do. If he wanted to come through and we go into worship or praise or whatever it is, if he wanted to come in and move in by his Spirit to the point to where I could not even minister, is according to the word of God, that the glory cloud came so that the priests, so much that the priest could not stand to minister. We've seen all of that. And that's because we yield to the power of God. Well, you can see that, or you can experience it when it happens virtually, but it won't be anything like you being in here and feeling the power of God. So there will always be, in all times, a need for the church. And this is not by any means to beat up on anybody. I don't want anybody to leave these two lessons saying, oh, Bishop is being hard and he's rebuking. No, I'm just simply addressing the times. I'm addressing what I know to be the feeling and the sentiment. Some of us that are not coming to church, it ain't because of COVID. It's not because of COVID. And you know it's not. Come on and say amen to me. I'm talking right up here. It's because we have become lazy. We have gotten complacent. We now generally, and there are some that genuinely are still navigating, trying to get comfortable coming back into being in contact with people. There's still some people that are still hesitant to hug and shake hands, and certainly you can understand why. I do, but there's got to be a time when we address the fact that the church has got to come back to being the church. And it is here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 11. This is why it's so necessary for corporate worship that we fellowship one with the other. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. That's the New International Version of the book of 1 Thessalonians. This is Paul writing to the church at Thessalonica. And he's telling them that he wants you to encourage one another. Watch this, not in this instance of encouraging yourself, but encourage one another. Here's the B part of that text, building each other up. Lord, bring back the day. Lord, hasten the day when the believers in Christ built each other up rather than tear each other down. That's a sermon all by itself. He just told the Thessalonian church, church at Thessalonica, that he wanted them to build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. And that's what we do when we come into corporate worship. We're building up each other. We're encouraging, at least we should be, and pushing each other to greatness. James chapter 5, verse 16, James believed to be the brother of Jesus. And it's here that he says, therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and it is effective. That's the New International Version. We will discover a satisfying sense of fulfillment when we begin to carry out our purpose in the body of Christ. We are the ones who miss out on the blessings of God and the gifts of our family members if we choose to not be a part of Christ's body. You don't know what you are missing and what you're robbing yourself of when you don't want to be a part of the body of Christ. You're missing out on the fellowship. You're missing out on the connection. One can chase 1,000, 2, 10,000. You're missing the touching and agreeing. You're missing, here's the part that's going to probably lose some viewers, accountability. Hallelujah. You cannot be an island unto yourself. It's cute for a while. It's real prim and proper for a while to be rocking by yourself. That's wonderful. But we all need and want somebody. And I'm not talking about sexually with your nasty self. Get your mind out the gutter. I'm not talking about relationships as it relates to romantic relationships. I'm talking about just the fellowship, the brotherhood, the sisterhood of the body of Christ. You can't get it anywhere. The world has tried to figure out for millennia, what is it about the church that unifies us so when we're on the right track and when we're not trying to be damaging one to the other? We can do great things, but we have to do it together as one family. As you come into the body of Christ, our leaders in the body of Christ offer spiritual protection. We find that in 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 1 through 4. To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder, be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, serving as overseers, not because you must, but because you are willing. Thank you, Jesus, as God wants you to be, not greedy for money, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. That's 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 1 through 4, admonishing the elders and the overseers, the pastors, the under shepherds, the angels of the house to be good shepherds of the flock. Well, we can't have no flock if we don't have no church. So that's why these individuals that are talking about, I'm pastor so-and-so, and you haven't received an appointment as an executive pastor or an associate pastor or a co-pastor. If you don't have a congregation, you're not a pastor. In order to be a pastor, you have to have a people. In order to be a bishop, you have to have people under your bishopric. Other leaders, a bishop is a pastor to pastors. Praise the Lord. And a pastor is a leader of the sheep. I'm going to say it again. A bishop is a leader to leaders, or a pastor to other pastors. A pastor is a leader to the sheep. That is the order of God. And he commanded that we follow this order until we all come into the unity of the faith. And I gave some apostles and I gave some teachers and some evangelists. Come on here for the perfecting of the church until we can all come into the unity of the faith. And so this is necessary for the growth of the church and for its matriculation and its sustainability, that its leaders be good shepherds of the flock. Hebrews 13 and 17 tells us to obey your leaders. All this is going to get good to us. I'm talking about the church. And there's a spirit of disobedience in the church. There's always going to be a few that are not going to always going to go contrary to what is supposed to happen. If we tell you to wear black and white, you'll show up in beige and gray, or black and cream, black and off-white. That ain't what we said. If we tell you to stand, you'll sit down. If we tell you to clap your hands, you wave your hand. There's always going to be somebody that goes against the grain. But the Bible tells us to obey your leaders. I'm in Hebrews 13 and 17, and submit to their authority. They keep watch over you as men who must give an account. Obey them so that their work will be a joy. Hello, not a burden, for that would be of no advantage to you. In the King James Version, I believe it reads, be subject to them that have rule over you. And I'm paraphrasing it, that they might do so with joy and not with grief, for that is not profitable for you. And so to be submissive, to obey, and to be in cooperation with the leaders is what makes for a strong church. Now, and I'm not telling you to be someone that just goes along to get along, because we want to lead people in truth and in righteousness. We don't want no Jim Jones repeats and leading people in false teaching and false prophets and erroneous doctrines. But when your leader, and I'm talking to people that may not even be members of my church, if you're a member of a church and you have a leader, you have a pastor that instructs you in truth and in wisdom, and they're not asking you to do no wicked and lascivious and downright dirty stuff, but if they're just asking you to do right, it's in probably in your best interest. No, I'm going to tell you, it is in your best interest to submit. You shouldn't be nowhere where you can't submit. Talk, Bishop. If you can't follow your leader, if you can't submit to his or her leadership, then you need to go to a church where you can be submissive and obey. That's a problem in this church in this season. There's a spirit of disobedience, and you want to do what you want to do because you grown and can't nobody tell me what to do. You're out of order, and the wrath of God and the judgment of God will be upon you when you disobey leadership. Everybody must be accountable to somebody. You don't deserve to be in authority over anything if you don't know and haven't learned how to be under authority. I don't care how many degrees you got. I don't care nothing about your level of anointing and how many garments you got, how many titles you've carried. I don't care that your daddy built the church with his hands and put the brick and the mortar together. I don't care nothing about that. If you're in authority, you have to first learn how to be under authority. You can't lead until you've been led. And while you're leading, you still need to be led, because everybody needs somebody. Somebody. Everybody needs somebody to lean on. And so that's what the Bible would declare. God has placed us into the body of Christ for our own protection. There's protection that comes in being in the body of Christ, for protection and blessing. Just like it is with our earthly families, being relational is not always fun. You're not going to always agree with everything that goes on in the church. And sometimes you will leave church upset, mad, frustrated, overwhelmed, overworked. These are all things that happen in the body of Christ. But then you got to have a mind of peace and reconciliation. You got to step back and say, hey, wait a minute. What do I need to do? What part did I play? Where do I need to be fixed and grow? And where do I need to do better? And when you determine and identify that, then it is always made better for you. And I think at some point we all need to ask ourselves, if my church was just like me, what kind of church would my church be? If a church was full of nobody but people just like you, what kind of church would that be? I think that's a good question to ask. And that's something that we can do, and as we look introspectively. Just like it is in your earthly families, you don't get along with all of your family members. There are some family members you have to do like my mama told me years ago. You got to learn how to love some people with a long-handled spoon. You're probably too young to know what I'm talking about. But if you grew up in the house like I grew up in, Mama had all these dishes, but there was this one tablespoon that had a handle on it that long. I never knew what that spoon was for. I knew it wasn't for eating soup because the handle was too long. It was good for stirring the Kool-Aid, I will tell you that. But you got to learn how to love people from a distance. There's never an excuse not to love. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I'm ministering to somebody. I don't care what they did to you. And I don't care how bad it hurt you. You still have to love. The Bible says you even got to love your enemies. Talk, Bishop. Pray for those that despitefully use you. Love your enemies and pray that God deliver them and bring them to a place of reconciliation. And so the church family is no different. You go to work every day on your job and I'll work there for 40 years, 30 years till you retire. And you're not going to like everybody, but you go every day. And you depend on what that job provides for you, a paycheck, benefits, job security. Why is the church any different? Is it because it doesn't offer some of the things that the world offers and some of these other avenues and venues? You're a part of sororities and fraternities. You don't like everybody there, but you're still a part. Amen. And so the church is no different, and we have to embrace this truth. We won't always have a warm and fuzzy feeling in the body of Christ. It's not going to always be a bed of roses. There are difficult and unlovely moments as we grow together as a family. But there are also blessings that will never be experienced unless we become connected with the body of Christ. There are some things you can't get until you get in the body. If you need any more reason to be a part of the body of Christ, I'll give you one more and I'll let you go. I've held you for 26 minutes already. Jesus Christ is our living example. He went to church as a regular practice. Jesus attended worship. That's in Luke 4:16. It says he went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue as was his custom. So even Jesus attended worship at the synagogue. I believe when he was a child, Mary was looking for him one day. Jesus slipped away from his mother and went to the synagogue, stood up and told him, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He hath anointed me to preach. He has sent me to heal the broken heart, to restore sight to the blind, to set at liberty to them that are bruised." Then he said, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me." And he did this in the synagogue on the day of worship, which was the Sabbath. If you have any serious doubts about the importance of church, I pray that you would look to God in the scriptures and be encouraged to know that it is right and good to be a part of the body of Christ. I'll leave you with Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. "Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." Hebrews 10, verse 25. Saints of God, I pray that this has been a blessing to you for the past 2 weeks. It's certainly something that I hold near and dear. And I just want to encourage you to know that if the church has ever been there for you in times of struggle, and the loss of a loved one, when it was time for you to get married, when it was time to dedicate a child, or when you was just having a bad week, but you showed up to church on Sunday and you had a heart and a mind ready to receive the word of God, and that word came and changed your life, the church was there for you. I admonish you to be there for the church. I love you and thank you for listening to me. I pray that this has been a blessing to you. If you can and if you will, get your mask, put on some clothes, and come to the house of God and meet me Sunday morning at 11:15. Don't worry about the number of the maxed amount of number that can be here. There's a place for you. Don't worry about any of that. Just get here before, I believe it's 11:30. Amen. Get here before 11:30. See, that's another reason why folks don't. Well, I heard, you know, the door's locked at 11:30. Accountability. Get up. Be on time. You got to be on time for work. You ought to be on time for worship. You ought to come running because God has something for you. And I don't want to be delayed on my miracle and my blessings. I stand in the need of a couple in this season. I'm running to the feet of God every chance I get. You do the same. I love you. I'll see you soon. If you can't be with us in person Sunday morning at 11:15, then tune in to the same place Sunday morning, and let's see what God will do for us. Remember, fasting tomorrow, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, from the time you get up until 3 p.m. Turn that plate over and let's seek God for the building and the strength of his church and for the success of our holy convocation next week. Wherever we are and whatever we do, let Christ always be our portion. I love you. Peace.